Americans refuse to use the metric system because they are an arrogant, insular people with an instinctive distrust of all international customs and institutions. They're also an ignorant, lazy people who refuse to change their ways even when their ways are demonstrably inferior. At least that's what some people say about us Americans. Is it true? I think, kinda, yeah, a little bit, but of course it's more complicated than that. Differences between people are the result of their circumstances at least as much as they're the result of anybody's intrinsic qualities, and I reckon that had any other people been in the unique circumstances of the industrial era United States, they probably would have resisted metrification too. And yes, from a historical perspective, this does have more to do with industry than it has to do with cooking or anything else, though we will get back to cooking. These are at least my personal conclusions after I went to the University of Georgia to visit Dr. Stephen Mim, a historian specializing in the subject of standards. He's working on a book about the metric system as we speak, and he cooks too. Hey, which system does he use in the kitchen?
Well, I would say I'm bilingual in terms of my measurements, and that I use cups, but I also have a gram scale, and I toggle back and forth on that pretty readily, depending on whether I'm using an American cookbook or a European cookbook.
Samesies, who says all Americans are monolingual? I'll tell you who says that, people who don't realize that America now has way more people from way more different places in it, but I digress. So why does Dr. Mim think America still hasn't gone metric?
So it's a question that Thomas Jefferson was probably the first to ask back in the 1790s, because it was during the French Revolution that the metric system was invented. And Jefferson was a big fan of the French, and actually seriously contemplated for a while the idea of nudging the new nation onto the metric system. But it was very hard to do because, one, it was a revolutionary thing, and it was politically fraught. There were a lot of people who didn't like the French, and so they kicked the can, basically, in the 1790s, and they decided instead to go with the existing set of measurements that had been inherited from Great Britain.
And indeed, Dr. Mim says the French were pretty resistant to metric too at first. For decades, it looked to US authorities as though metrification was a global failure.
And then by the time they revisited it again in the 1860s and 1870s, where they began to legalize the use of the metric system, something very momentous had happened in the meantime, which is that the United States had industrialized. And the railroads and precision manufacturing and machine tools all require very precise mechanics that rely on units of measurement, namely the inch. And the entire industrial base had been tooled up, and quite successfully by the 1870s, the United States is the biggest economy in the world. It had been tooled up in this old antiquated system of measurement. And so when metric advocates suddenly show up in the 1870s and 80s and starts, you know, pounding on the table and saying, we need to go metric, the industrialists of the country say, no, we're not going to do that. That's a stupid idea. And they have various rationalizations for it.
Let's start with a debatably good rationale. US customary measurements may be better than metric for certain industrial applications, like machine shop work.
For milling out a pipe thread. Because it's a binary system where you have an inch as the core unit, and then the subdivisions are half, quarter, eighth, 16th, 32nd. So for mechanics working on the shop floor, dividing by half is a very intuitive thing.
In contrast, a base 10 measurement system can make it kind of harder to divide by half. A centimeter is 10 millimeters. Half of that is 5 millimeters, no problem there. But then half of that, a quarter, is 2.5. Half of that, an eighth, is 1.25. Half of that, a 16th, is 0.625. And a 32nd is 0.3125. Ugh. There's a theory as to why measurement systems descended from the Brits and the Romans before them are built around numbers like 12 and 16 rather than 10. 12 and 16 have more factors, therefore they're more easily divisible, or so this theory goes. A pound of, say, flour is 16 ounces. If I want to cut my recipe in half, it's 8 ounces. If I want to make a quarter batch, it's 4 ounces. Half of that is 2, and half of that is 1, and quantities of flour less than an ounce are pretty rare here in the kitchen, so who cares if the numbers are going to start to get ugly if we keep dividing? If the pound were instead base 10, like metric, and there were 10 ounces of flour in a pound, half of a half of a half of a half of a pound would be 0.625 ounces, which is an ugly number compared to 1 ounce, which is what it is in the real world. Now, the metric system deals with this problem by making its core units much smaller. Just 1 pound of flour is 454 grams. That's a way bigger number, so it's an easier number to divide down without getting into some long, ugly decimals, as long as you're cool with rounding up or down to the nearest gram, which of course you would be, because a fraction of a gram is going to make no meaningful difference in any recipe. Now that works, but the problem with grams and millimeters is that they're so small compared to the size of the things that we actually tend to measure in real life. As a result, the metric system is arguably a little bit less intuitive. Dr. Mim says it's a similar deal in an industrial context. An inch, half an inch, an eighth of an inch.
Cognitively, that makes more sense for someone scaling things on the increment of, say, a screw thread.
Okay, so in your head, you're probably screaming counter-arguments to everything that you've heard so far, because this is a pretty thin line of reasoning to resist the metric system. Indeed, shop rats around the world are milling things out right now using the metric system, and they're doing just fine. There was a more compelling, though perhaps less noble, reason why the United States resisted metric in the late 19th century, and we will discuss what it is just after I thank the sponsor of this video, HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. Go to HelloFresh.com and use code AdamRagusia10 during HelloFresh's New Year's sale for 10 free meals, including free shipping. It doesn't much matter which measurement system you prefer when a HelloFresh box comes to your door, because most of the ingredients come pre-measured. That's part of what makes cooking with HelloFresh fun, easy, and affordable. There's tons of menu options to choose from. This month we're doing the Calorie Smart Plan, hence this lovely fish dish that Lauren and I are making. We like cooking these together. Instead of stressing out going to the grocery store and making sure that you got everything, we just open up the box and follow these foolproof instructions. We can relax and have fun talking to each other while we cook. And you can cook more sustainably this way too. There's way less food waste than you might normally have, and the packaging is almost entirely made from recyclable and or already recycled material. If we decide that we're done with this calorie smart thing, we can easily change our plan or our delivery days or skip a week whenever we want. But after half an hour of easy cooking, that is very tasty. I do not feel calorie deprived. HelloFresh is now from $5.66 per serving. Use my code AdamRagusia10 at HelloFresh.com to get 10 free meals, including free shipping, during HelloFresh's New Year's sale. That's all in the description. And now for the more compelling reason why the United States resisted metric in the late 19th century. It was all about the machinery of the Second Industrial Revolution. The gears and chains and switches that would go on to save your asses in two world wars, Brits! Those machines had already been built to work on one system, and Dr. Mim says industrialists simply didn't want to have to rebuild them.
The key opposition that you see emerging in Congress and in the halls of technical journals and the like comes from engineers.
So now you might be wondering, well, the Brits used British imperial units. I mean, it's right there in the name. And Britain was the birthplace of the Industrial Revolution. They had huge machines built to run on feet and pounds, machines that they no doubt didn't want to have to rebuild. And the Brits also have an instinctive distrust of the French, but even the Brits went metric, so what's wrong with you Yankees? Good question. But let's remember that the Brits did resist metrification for a long time. Some of them even fell back on this absurd pseudoscience they'd invented about how the inch is divinely prescribed in nature, which is why you can see it in the designs of the Great Pyramids of Egypt, which of course is not actually true. But anyway, Britain did indeed resist metrification well into the 20th century, and then...
By the 1950s, 1960s, Britain is deindustrializing. And so what had once been the key part of its economy had started to fall away, and it did so earlier than we started to deindustrialize, and it did so much more fully.
In contrast, the United States in the mid-20th century was the undisputed industrial heavyweight champion of the world. The captains of industry didn't want to rejigger their assembly lines, and Congress generally did whatever the captains of industry told them to do. The Brits also had much closer ties to the metric world, perhaps by virtue of being much closer to the metric world. Americans were more geographically isolated, and also...
Exports have historically been less important for the United States. And the domestic market has been the primary driver of growth. unlike Japan or Germany, where the export markets are where it's all at.
Indeed, the big reason why the United States resisted metric in the mid-20th century may simply have been that we could.
The United States has had the luxury of being the world's largest economy, and as such, can effectively operate according to its own rules.
It's rather like language. Are so few Americans multilingual because we're just a bunch of dummies? No, it's because as a legacy of British and then American global hegemony, you can get very, very far in this world only speaking English. So most of us simply don't have to learn another language. Now, you could argue that we Americans become dummies as a result of that, because we never acquire the cultural competence that you can get by learning someone else's language. You sure could make that argument. You don't want to hear my high school Spanish. This maybe gets at why post-industrial America continues to resist metric. It's the privilege of hegemony. It makes you lazy. And then when your hegemony starts to slip, it makes you resentful and paranoid. Turns you into
people who view the metric system as a form of global governance that undercuts American sovereignty.
And it's among such folks where opposition to the metric system is primarily concentrated here in the United States these days. And also with our tradition of federalism, there's a lot of ideological opposition to the kind of centralized government regulation that it can take to move a society off of the standards to which everyone is accustomed. And yet, without any heavy-handed government action at all, lots of Americans have been quietly adopting the metric system for decades now. Scientists and medical professionals almost exclusively use metric on the job anymore.
When our doctors write a prescription for a painkiller, we don't go, you know, absolutely not. I insist that you measure this in grains and drams. Pharmaceutical companies and also druggists realized, and they were right, that the metric system really did have serious advantages because of its precision and its scalability in the powers of 10.
Which are the very same reasons why a lot of people who work in food in the United States have been adopting metric too, in particular pastry chefs. They love the precision you can get with smaller units of measurement. Dr. Mim reckons that US customary measures will end not with a bang, but with a whimper, as more and more Americans just kind of peel off to metric on their own. Certainly the main reason that I still use US customary in my recipes is just that that's how ingredients come to me packaged in my grocery store. But I wonder how much longer I'll stick with it. My job these days is to write recipes for you, and while the plurality of you are in the US, the majority of you are somewhere else, and I can already feel your influence on how I think and communicate in measurements. In that sense, what you and I are doing on the internet right now is driving the very globalization that a lot of Americans find threatening. Americans on the political right and left, by the way, though perhaps for different reasons. I myself tend to think that globalization is, on balance, a really good thing. Not the least because it has allowed us to enjoy each other's food way more. And long may we continue to do that.